Today I'm drinking an old favorite, Fort Garry Dark English Mild Ale. Just a nice mellow beer, and I'm told by some British expatriates that this tastes quite like what they remember from home. So today I am tinkering with these attiny13 little tiny little microcontrollers that I got in the last mailbag, and a few related things to them too. So these little guys, things that I've discovered about them so far in my tinkering around, they are pin compatible for the slightly bigger brother attiny85, which is kind of neat. So you can drop them into each other's circuit as long as the software isn't too carried away, because the attiny85 can handle a much larger program. It has much larger RAM and program ROM and everything else. But you can use them interchangeably in certain circumstances. So the attiny13 has 1K of program flash, which is not a huge amount. 64 bytes each of EEPROM and static RAM. It has 2 PWM channels. I believe the attiny85 can do 4. It has 4 ADC, analog digital converter inputs. It can run, depending on the version that you've got, down to 1.8 volts or down to 2.7 volts and up to 5.5 volts. Again, depending on the version that you've got, up to 10 megahertz. There's the pinout, and as I said, it is pin compatible with the attiny85 as well. Power, ground, digital IO, or IO pins, I guess, 0 through 5. Typically, you don't use 5 because it's also the chip reset, although you can do some low of a messing around to use it if you need to. You need an extra one, but normally you'd use these 5 here from 0 to 4. And again, there's the analog digital converters. One of them is on that PB5 or reset, so you generally would be avoiding it unless you needed it. You don't need to use an external crystal. It's got an internal oscillator, but you could if you chose to. So there's a couple of different ways to get programming onto these little chips. They both claim to be fairly straightforward. One of them I've never had any luck with, no matter what chip I'm trying to program, and that includes this attiny13. But it is Arduino as ISP. Basically, you load a sketch onto your Arduino, which turns it into an ICSP, in-circuit system programmer. And you hook up a Mozzie Measle system clock and a reset, plug it in, and do a little bit of software magic in the IDE, and boom. Most of the tutorials that I've read just say it just works. But as I said, I've never had it work with an attiny85, with an attiny13, and I've tried 2 or 3 of them with ATmega328. I don't know why. Maybe it's my software, maybe it's just the way I'm holding my mouth wrong. If you have better experience with that, please comment down below. I'd love to hear your experience. But in the meantime, there is another way that does work for me consistently, and that is the USB-ASP. This has a little microcontroller on it too, but all it does is act like a programmer. You plug it into USB, you plug in, again, there's Mozzie Measle, system clock, reset, power, and ground on there. And a couple of other pins, but we don't need them for that. All we need really is 6 pins. There's these adapters for some boards. And actually, on the Uno, there's the header there with the 6 pins that you need. So if I needed to program that one with this, I could do that just with this little pin adapter here and plug on. Or you could just plug the wires into the appropriate pins and plug onto the breadboard with this guy, and away you go. But there is another way. Anthony at One Circuit sent me this some time ago, and it is an adapter to go from the USB-ASP cable to an attiny chip. Oops. If my big mitts would do this properly. There, you just plug that in. Plug that into your computer, and boom, good to go. So here I've got the standard blink sketch. So the only modification I've made to the blink sketch is to change the predefined LED built into just pin 4 directly, just to hard code it. One less thing to go wrong. On the Arduino webpage, there's this page with the programming attiny with Arduino. I'm not going to do that, but it does have some information that we need. You need to copy this line of board definition into your IDE so that it knows where to pick up the attiny13 board definitions and stuff. And that just pastes into here in preferences. I've already got it in there. Then from tools, you can go and pick the attiny13 off the list. I don't know if these matter or not. I've got it set to the 1.2 meg internal oscillator, and I don't know what BOD is, but 4.3 was what was suggested in that article I was just in, and it works, so we'll go with that. Then you choose the programmer as usb-asp, as I have there. Plug in your usb-asp into your USB, and then sketch upload using programmer. Don't use the normal upload, because that's we don't have the serial adapter in here using TX and RX. We're using the ICSP, so just upload using programmer. It complains down here for reasons that I don't understand, but it says done uploading. So I'm going to accept that is exactly what it says, done uploading. So this case is still connected to the USB-ASP right now, just for power. But since I put a blink sketch in there on pin 4, there we go. We have a blink sketch. So I could even just disconnect that and connect power and ground, except for I need the ground for this, so I'm not going to do that. Actually, we'll maybe throw it onto a breadboard and do that, just to show how little you actually need. There we go. That's all it takes to get a microcontroller working. Now, of course, I could have programmed up other things to happen on the other pins. And actually, let me just do that. Okay, so I've just gone away and quickly reprogrammed it. You don't need to see me reprogramming it every single time. But I've put a simple little charlieplexing script on there now, which is actually the same one that I wrote for a video a month or two ago when I was playing with charlieplexing. And since then, I built up this little board, which is just very standard little charlieplexing. So this first pair of LEDs is connected in parallel, but positive to negative, or anode to cathode. So if you put voltage on it in one polarity, one of them lights up. You put voltage on it in the other polarity, the other one lights up. And as you can see, I've only got three wires connected to this, but I've got six LEDs. And of the three circuits, the LEDs just pick up off different permutations of the three available tracks to get power to all six LEDs. So, with the three pins of the little microcontroller, we can do this. Control six. Hello. What just... Ah, there's a delay in there. Okay. I should have speeded it up, but whatever. But ain't that cool? I think we can go bigger, though, because we have four I.O. pins that we can play with. So, let me just go away and see if I can expand this a little bit. Okay, that took some time. Mostly in the trying to get these LEDs in a straight line on here, which didn't work all that well, but whatever. So now we have four circuits connected to the four pins called PB1234. There is a fifth one available, but I'm not going to use it because it would make this charlieplexing thing about that long. So, and I'm starting to run out of red LEDs, which reminds me I'm going to have to order some more. Look out for those coming in a mailbag sometime in, 6 months from now. Anyway, where was I? Oh yeah, right. So I've got that same chip, again reprogrammed. I just doubled up my charlieplexing sketch to do the same thing across four different circuits instead of eight, or instead of three. And basically, there's how it's wired out. So the first two LEDs are on the first two, positive, negative, negative, positive. The third and fourth LEDs are across circuits two and three. Again, positive, negative, right? And then the five and six are across one and three. Seven and eight are across one and four. Nine and 10 are across two and three. 11 and 12 are across three and four. So with that, I can control all 12 of these LEDs. Now, you don't have to obviously run them in a straight line. You can bounce them around or whatever. Or if you go really fast and multiplex them, you can have the appearance that there's any number of them on at any given time. But that's way more programming than I'm interested in doing. So that's kind of neat. And again, that's just power, some resistors, and stack of LEDs. So what other fun things can we do with it? Well, I mean, you can, any place you need four or five pins off a microcontroller, you can use this guy. No trouble. But one other fun thing, also sent in by Anthony, was these little boards here. He calls them a stable jewel thief. And it is basically a jewel thief circuit, not the traditional one with discrete components like Big Clive likes to make. This one uses the QX5252, which is this little 4-pin chip here, which is what's in those little solar-powered garden lights. All you need to is that, a little inductor, and a couple of diodes, and a smoothing capacitor. And with that, you can take your programmed attiny13 and plug it in there. I've reprogrammed this yet again with the blink sketch back on it. Where did my LED go? There it is. So we will put the LED again between ground and PB4. And we'll power it off a AA battery, which is going to be somewhere in the 1.5 volts or less range. Now, you're probably aware that 1.5 volts is not really enough to power this thing. The datasheet said it wants, closer to 1.8 volts minimum, right? And I'm impressed that this thing can handle the current, actually. But there's what we've got coming out of it. When the LED's not dragging the current down, let's just pull it out. We've got close to 4.5 volts, which is well within the range of this guy. And with the LED in there, it does drag it down some, but still not enough to kill it. So I've just quickly programmed up another one of the attinys and put it back onto this board. And let's see now, positive is there. I like Anthony's boards. They've all got the headers broken out. So now if we connect the ground to that, that 1.5 volt battery is powering two microcontrollers and two LEDs at any given time off a 1.5 volt battery. That is pretty slick. I'll put a link to Anthony's blog spot and to his YouTube channel down in the description if you want to go and check out his stuff. He's got some pretty clever circuits, actually. Anyway, this was never intended to be a big in-depth look at these things. This was just, I was tinkering around and figured I'd bring you guys along with me, as I often do. I hope you found something interesting in this, and comments and questions down below as usual. As I said, I'd link to Anthony's websites and stuff, just because he's got some cool stuff that you might want to check out. Thanks for watching. I'll talk to you later.